Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Bismillah. Welcome back to another session of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I, the Summer Seerah series with Muslim Space. Last time in our third session, we covered topics that included the intensifying persecution of the Quraysh, which resulted in the Muslims having to, many of the Muslims having to migrate to Abyssinia, present day kind of Ethiopia, for refuge. We talked about how this intensified persecution resulted in martyrdoms, notably the martyrdom of Sumayya and Yasir, the first martyrs of Islam. We talked about how amidst this persecution, amidst this migration, there were also some very miraculous, per se, conversions that occurred with Hamza and Umar that gave the Muslim community some much needed respite and sources of strength during a time when persecution was intensifying and at its height. We also saw how, despite this persecution attempt, as the Muslims had these power moves that were essentially made with Hamza and Umar coming into the fold, that there were these reconciliation attempts between the Quraysh and the Muslims to try and just settle whatever the difference might be and to just, you know, remove any of the tensions that existed. But we saw that those had fallen through and how that resulted in essentially a ban on the Muslims, on the clan of the Prophet, the Banu Hashim, and their relatives, the Banu Muttalib. And so there's this boycott that occurred, as well as beyond the boycott, we see how the Prophet during this time in the community were most vulnerable, but especially the Prophet experienced not just a literal boycott, but also experienced the tragedies of the passing away of someone who was like his father figure in Abu Talib, who had taken care of him from a young age and had been by his side. And despite the fact that he had not formally accepted Islam in that sense, was someone who pledged his support to the Prophet ﷺ and had defended him throughout against the Meccan elite. And so this was a huge blow to the Prophet ﷺ, not just in terms of a political alliance or any kind of political reason, but also on a personal reason, because Abu Talib really was kind of like a father figure that he never had. And then you also had the passing of his main confidant, his supporter, his comforter, who was the coolness of his eyes. You had Khadija radhiyallahu anha, who had passed away as well. And as we know, we shared some stories of how at the time before, at his marriage, as well as after the revelation, how she was a consistent source of just uplifting the Prophet when he was down, how she was someone who was always there for him. And we see that the Prophet also found in her so much that he probably would not feel like he got in any other marriage that he may have in the years to come. How we talked about how Khadija was there when no one else was there for him, how Khadija supported him when no one else did. And because there was also this, there's a slight age gap between the Prophet ﷺ as well as Khadija. Khadija was someone who was twice widowed. She was somebody that also had this experience of being a motherly figure. And so having those qualities, those traits of motherliness, not just towards the children that her and the Prophet ﷺ raised, but also those elements that the Prophet ﷺ may not have gotten when he was kind of growing up without a mother. Remember, his mom passed away when he was just six. So there's a disconnect there in terms of him being raised and him being brought up by a motherly figure. And you see Khadija in raising the kids and supporting the Prophet ﷺ provides that kind of motherly love that was void. And so you see these multiple losses that the Prophet ﷺ endures in a short amount of time. And eventually we talked about how seeking refuge from Mecca, he goes to Taif. He has a very bad experience at Taif, where he is, you know, stoned out and driven out. We saw how he is basically at the end of his rope. He just feels like he's kind of given up at that sense, and how he experiences the journeys of Israh and Miraj, you know, going from the corporeal to the spiritual and the ethereal, and being able to be connected with the divine, connected with the hereafter, and finding respite, if not on this world, in the next. And we talked about how finally relief had come from Yathrib, from the northern city of Yathrib, where pledges were finally made at Aqaba, where the beginning of the Muslim community and the foundations of a new home were being built. And we left off on talking about how the Hijrah now started to come into play, how it was being prepared for. And so, as we mentioned, as always in these sessions, keep these things in mind. Think about what it takes to build a community. Think about what it takes to leave a community. Think about what it takes to leave a home. Think about what it means to see yourself and see your family, your loved ones, your friends, your own life, your society, your struggles within the biography of the Prophet, especially during this time, which we'll talk about, which will go from the Hijrah up until the doorstep of the Battle of Badr. So we're not going to cover the Battle of Badr. We'll just kind of inch close to it. Inshallah, next time we'll talk about the Battle of Badr and go from there. But as we mentioned, continuing from last time, the Hijrah was, you know, this migration away from the Meccan society, which had become so constrictive, so unlivable, so unbearable, that it was now commanded upon Muslims to begin to migrate to a new home. And as I mentioned, that it wasn't just a random command that came and said, hey, okay, now go migrate. There were steps in process. The Prophet ﷺ was not just someone who was just preaching out there and saying, hey, you know, come to Islam. We've got a great deal for you. You know, you can be Muslims, you can do this. But the Prophet ﷺ also worked in tangible pledges, worked in tangible relations, and worked these things with people, especially in Yathrib, to actually not just have a place where, hey, you can take us in, we're seeking asylum, just take care of us and just give us protection and we'll do that. It was more mutual. It was more on the foundation of the community. It was like, okay, because the Yathrib community, as we had mentioned, they were experiencing their own kinds of conflicts. And so they were seeking a remedy for those. They were seeking mediation. And so they found in this person of the Prophet ﷺ, who not only offered them a faith or a tradition, but also offered them to help them with that issues. And so you see that it takes a process. It wasn't just something like, okay, hey, things are unbearable, now go and leave. It took a process. It took almost 13 years, which the Hijrah had then taken place 13 years or so after the first revelation. So you can see they were in Mecca for quite a bit of time before they were given that permission to leave. And so just keeping that in mind. Now, what was the economic, social, political risk behind this? Hijrah was not just something that, hey, we get up and we do one day, or like, hey, I don't like it here, so I'm just gonna leave. We talked about how this society was so interconnected, so connected, especially on the ties of kinship, the ties of tribeship, the tribal mentality. There's so much of that ingrained that leaving in this society just to get up and to go and to just announce that, hey, I'm leaving. And this was a leaving that was not done for many people in the sense of like, hey, you know, I'm just taking a vacation, I'll come back. All right, I'm just going to go and come back. No, this was like, hey, I'm leaving, like I'm going. And so there was so much uncertainty around it, but it was not just a formal like, hey, I'm going to leave. And I'll just come back when things get better. It was like, hey, I'm leaving. This might be the last time you ever see me. And so it was a risky enterprise. It was a frightening step, especially because nobody knew how well it would work out. The Muslims were still a small minority. And you had also not just the fear of the societal aspect of it, but you had the literal fear of the fact of this journey was through not a I-35 corridor, through a road that had roadside assistance or anything like that. This was 200 miles that was through the desert and rocky terrain. It was not habitable. It's not exactly an ideal place to go for travel, especially when you're going in that distance for about 2 to 3 weeks and in that temperature, in that climate. It was just not an ideal thing for people to have to take on. You have to have so many other things lined up in terms of resources, in terms of just being ready for the worst. And so there's just so much that was going on there. So we know that we recognize that the Hijrah was not just a concept where people were just like, okay, hey, you know, Mecca's not working out. All right, I'll just go to Medina. No, there's so much more that's involved in it that maybe people didn't want to go on the Hijrah. Maybe people were just like, I don't know. Like, you know, my home is here. I was born here. Why do I have to leave? Like, you know, think about these questions that might've been asked and probably were asked by the Muslims that were on the margins. And for many Muslims that had to migrate and had to leave their families behind. we know that also during the migration, it wasn't just a clean getaway for most people. A lot of people actually had experienced different kinds of losses. They had experienced different kinds of separation. The family of Abu Salama, as they were leaving, his wife and child were taken away from him. And so the families were separated. Other people were forced to were captured by their families and forced to revert and have to renounce the faith of the Prophet. So there was different persecution that went on. It wasn't just that, hey, I migrate. Okay, great, I'm safe now. But there was so much risk that was attached to it because it just didn't end right there. So we think about this concept of leaving. We think about this notion of hijrah, and we see that there's so much more that is there than we often give it credit. And we think about it in our context today when we see people migrating at the border, in the border between US and Mexico. And we see the stories, not just the fact that people here are sometimes reduced to statistics, like X amount of migrants coming to the border, or people are flooding the border, or whatnot. Look at their stories. Look at their stories and look at what they're fleeing from. Look at what they're desiring, why they're coming here. Look at how they are coming here. Look at the journeys that they've traveled. Look at the mileage that they've endured on their two feet. Like, look at the state that they're coming out, the economic, social, political, emotional dimensions to it. And you'll see that there's many commonalities in their flight, in their departure, in their migration, in their struggle that there was, and especially is, to that which we hold sacred in Islam, of the people who we call the muhajirun, the people who migrated, and those whom the Quran lifts up in a sense of giving favor to those who migrate. And so make that connection. Think about that migration is not just something, especially in its sacredness, was not just something that was limited to 13 years after revelation as an event that just marks the Islamic calendar, but there's sacrifice. There's so much that's packed in there. And when we think about how the second Khalifa of Islam, Umar radiallahu anhu, had set the date of, or set the Islamic calendar to start with the Hijrah, just think about how much is packed into that beyond like, hey, this was a date we recognize. Cool, let's just use that as a date and we go forward. Think about what that means just for the Muslim psyche, that it was placed not on a date of it could have been the conquest of Mecca that he set, you know, the date. This is when, you know, Islam won, or Islam essentially had a victory over pre-Islamic Arabia. So let's set it there. No, it was set on a year when there was absolute struggle. There was a sense of liberation, but there was also so much more that was packed into it. There was a struggle for survival. There was this people that were exhausted. You have all these different things that are kind of packed in. And so we see the Hijrah not just as something that is a year, that's a marker, not just as a decision that ended up being made, but you see it as an overwhelming commitment, a risk, something that was a required mind, body, and soul to go through. And some people had paid the full price for it. Some people were prevented. Some people ended up going out. Some people ended up making it. It was just so many different things happening. But we see that there's so much more to the Hijrah, as I mentioned, than we give credit for. So now as we go through the Hijrah, we also see that beyond the few hundred or so Muslims, there weren't many Muslims at that time comparatively. So it wasn't that, like, you know, half of the town of Mecca or whatnot decided to just up and leave. There was a handful of Muslims, or a substantial amount, at least in that sense. But in retrospect, many scholars see that, you know, maybe a few hundred, if that, maybe 70, maybe 100, maybe just, you know, not that many people that were there. And so you see that it wasn't like a mass migration, but it was people going in pockets and, you know, limited aspects here. And so we see that among these groups that were going, you also see that the Prophet ﷺ was one of the people who had to migrate as well. And so we see that as the Prophet ﷺ, his circumstances for migration were maybe a little bit different than other folks. Other folks, you know, were given the approval to migrate, and were given the commandment, essentially, to migrate, to leave Mecca because of how things had become so unbearable. And so they were, you know, given a directive and told that you can now migrate and you should migrate. So they were given that. For the Prophet ﷺ, because he was essentially public enemy number one within the establishment's eyes in Mecca, you see that in his life, his protector, Mutim ibn Adi, who we mentioned was a non-Muslim who had given him protection after he had returned from Ta'if, he had passed away. And so now he had passed away. The Prophet, again, Prophet ﷺ, again, was someone who was basically a open target for everybody. He was open in a sense of there was no restriction for people to say, okay, he has no protection, so we can now remove him per se. And so you have Abu Jahl, who we talked about was quite a bit of an opponent, to say the least, of the Islamic cause, of the Prophet Muhammad, proposing a solution in which he essentially wants to end this matter of Islam, end this question of Islam, this movement of Muhammadism and all this. He wants to end it. And he proposes essentially an assassination, point blank, an assassination, but one that is done, not that it leaves anybody out of the mix, in a sense that, oh, if someone is to kill the Prophet Muhammad, the Arab ties of tribalism and retribution still apply. So there would be blood money that's paid. There's a targeting of just one tribe. So he proposes a solution that all of the tribes, essentially, with the exception of the clan of the Prophet, will share in essentially killing the Prophet. So kind of like a Caesar type of assassination, where everybody will join in and have a hand in it. That way, responsibility cannot be pinpointed on just one tribe or one clan or one group. And so he proposes a solution. People, the other tribes, people buy into it. And so you see that the Prophet is now basically, you know, just a open target for these people, and they have devised this plan. And you see that the Prophet still at this time, and even before, doesn't migrate. He's still waiting, and he waits to the end. He says in a quote to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu that wait for a while, because Abu Bakr asks him for permission to leave. And so he says, wait for a while, because I hope that I will be allowed to emigrate also. So think about the weight of that statement, that I hope that I will be allowed to emigrate also. So you see this agency for himself. Oftentimes we see in public figures and leaders, especially in religious leaders and movements, that they will first and foremost remove themselves and they'll get to safety. We see this concept of getting the leader to safety, and then we will, everybody else will go. We see in the concept of, when the president of the United States is, if anything kind of happens, you have to give the president the security, you have to give anybody this kind of privilege and the security above everybody else. And so you have these special circumstances, you have these special preparations. But for the Prophet ﷺ in the Muslim community, you didn't have this. You didn't have this concept where it was that, okay, hey, let's get the Prophet ﷺ out first, because he's the only connection to Islam and Allah and revelation that we have. So let's get him out first, and then all of us can come later. No, you see it the other way around, that he's getting everybody out first. The Muslim community is being moved out first to at least have a community, and then you are bringing the Prophet ﷺ to this new place. But you see this in reverse of what we traditionally consider, that how you build a community. How you build a community, do you do it with its centerpiece at the center, and you move that and then you build around it, or do you move the bulk of it and then build, put the centerpiece back in and help to grow it? So it's a different model, but it gives you an idea that how significant this was, not just for him as a person, but also for his role as a prophet, also for Islam, how it came to develop. So it made certain that he would be in a strong and independent position when he would reach Medina, because now he's there and he has a group of supporters that are on, not essentially on their own, but they have autonomy. They don't have to worry about being persecuted. They don't have to worry about being scattered and separated, that they have consolidation, and he will be able to go to a place that has that foundation. So he's foundation building in this community. And we see that he himself doesn't know when he's going to go to Medina. So it testifies to his prophethood that he could have easily just said, hey, I'm the prophet of God, give me privilege, I'm going to just go there, because without me, you're not going to have religion or God. You see that he is awaiting instruction to be able to go. And so we want to lift this up. We lifted this up last time, but remember how the Prophet ﷺ left, and we left Mecca. And we also want to remember how he comes. We see that the Prophet ﷺ, when he left, he settled all his debts and matters, that he set, he with his cousin Ali, he made sure that Ali would take care of any outstanding debts or any things that he may have borrowed or anything like that gets settled with people, he himself would take care of that before he left. But you see him tying these loose ends, anything that's like that. He had the absolute excuse to be like, hey, my life is in danger. I am basically like liable to be killed by any of these people. Like, you know, they are going to be coming after me. I don't have protection. So he had the absolute right to get out of there and for his own safety, but he chose to tie up his debts and the things that he had committed to and fulfill those matters. And then he started to go on his journey. He didn't do it before he finished those, or at least set a process in motion that would take care of those things. So we talked about last time how he made this powerful statement that I think is just really necessary to lift up as well, that how he stood on a hill looking back at Mecca as he was leaving. He says, you know, of all of God's earth, you are the dearest place to me. You are the dearest unto God. And had not my people driven me out from you, I wouldn't have left you. And we see how Professor Omid Safi talked about that. The hijrah was neither an abandonment of Mecca nor the forgetting of where one had come from. It was the determination to rise up from oppression with the intention of returning eventually to redeem even the oppressor. But you see how the Prophet ﷺ was not just leaving a place just like, hey, it's uninhabitable, I'm gonna go find something else, and all right, we'll go try there. But this was his home, you know, this was his homeland. And again, we talked about the connection of migration in our day and the struggle of the migrants of those in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And we lift up that the concept of home, that it's just, oh, they might be, they're fleeing their countries. They're leaving there, they just wanna come here. They wanna take our jobs. They wanna do this, they wanna do that. We think about where are they leaving? You know, they have homes. They had homes. You know, some of them, even if not like a literal home, you know, they're coming from a place they called home. There's something sacred that's there, and that forced them to leave. You know, that forced them to have to make that decision to walk thousands of miles for something that's not guaranteed. And so, think about that struggle. What's the sacred in there? So we contrast, though, as we come back to this in a few sessions, the escape of the Prophet ﷺ in the dark of night away from the assassins. There's a famous story of how, you know, all the assassins basically came to take out the Prophet ﷺ, but you know, he had escaped, you know, prior, or he had escaped in the middle of the night, and they found instead his cousin Ali sleeping in his space. And so you see him leaving in the cover of the night, very discreetly, not notifying anybody. And, you know, just with pockets of people just leaving earlier and then a few people coming after them. But you contrast that with the return, where he comes back to Mecca with thousands of, you know, supporters, thousands of people who have accepted Islam. And he takes the city in a very peaceful manner. But you see the concept, the triumph that comes back, and that's contrasted in the middle of the day, you know, comes forth, and as opposed to leaving in the dark of the night. So in his own journey, we see how he travels with his companion Abu Bakr, and how Abu Bakr's own family, once the Prophet ﷺ leaves, they actually don't go straight up to Medina. They go south a few miles to where the cave of Thor is. And so they go south about 5 miles or so, where the cave of Thor is. And Abu Bakr's family, while they're there for a few days, provides provisions. And so this it's a collective effort. So you see how his family is still in Mecca at the time, but they are part of this resistance, this type of resistance that is occurring, and they are giving provisions. And you also see that once they get set to go to Medina, you see that there's also not just help of family members in this aspect of family helping, but you see the help of non-Muslims again coming to Muslims. And so we have Abdullah ibn Urayt, the guide essentially that was hired by Abu Bakr, who was a non-Muslim, who wasn't a Muslim, but was someone who was hired to help get them to Medina. And so we see how they had gone through this you know, escape in the middle of the night. They went to the cave of Thor, they waited there for a few days. There's also a famous story of how they eluded the Meccans that were there through miraculous means or so, and how there's this reassurance by the Prophet ﷺ while they're in this cave and the Meccans are outside, that God is with them, that God is with them, and there's a revelation that concerns that. But they eventually embark back towards Medina once you know, that scare is removed, and it's a 16 to 20 day journey that they take on through this desert, through this harsh climate, up until they finally get to the first the town or the village of Quba, just outside of Yathrib. But we talked a little bit about here, what's the significance of the Hijrah? What's the significance of the Hijrah, the sociological, the psychological, the economic, because there's so much more to the Hijrah than, as I mentioned, we give credit for. Sociologically, we see that the tribe was the most sacred value of all in Arabia. This act of Hijrah essentially was tantamount to blasphemy for some people. The root of Hijrah, as I mentioned, has a connotation of cutting off, has a connotation of dislocation, of forming a new identity and value and just severing off that which is old. And so Hijrah is not just one to migrate, but one to just establish something new, but to do it in such a manner that you cut it and you start anew. And so psychologically as well, the Hijrah required above all a trust in God. It required this tawakkul. It required to relieve yourself of arrogance, to relieve yourself of a dependence on people, and also to then depend on Allah, to transfer that dependence on Allah away from the material, away from people. So we see this exile, not just an exile that is literal in terms, we see an exile that is of the conscience, of the heart, of the idols, of that which distances from God. And we relate that to our time today. What are our idols? What are the ways that we live in life? What are the way that our society has conditioned us to be? What are the things that are kind of holding us in a space that we're not comfortable and we need to get some relief? So the Hijrah is not just one that's a literal event that happened 1400 years ago or so. This isn't just that. The Hijrah is also something that has a mental and psychological component to it. And so we look at it from this aspect that what do we, and what did the Prophet, the people of the Prophet ﷺ, the early Muslims, what did they turn away from? What idols did they turn away from? What idols do we turn away from when we want to make a Hijrah, when we want to just get that space and move on and get to a better place away from this? What idols did they have? What idols do we have? What lies and what unethical ways of life are we emigrating from? What lies and unethical ways of life did they emigrate from? What did they liberate themselves from and break free from? What can we liberate ourselves from and break free from if we choose to make Hijrah in our time, not in the literal sense that we go and we walk 200 miles to the nearest town or place of refuge, but we make that Hijrah in this context of removing ourselves from whatever it may be that is holding us back. And so we see the physical journey of Medina was also one that was a spiritual journey of self-discovery. And so Hijrah was a migration from Jahiliyyah, but it was also a migration. It was not just a migration from Mecca to Medina, but it was also a migration from Jahiliyyah to Islam, because it put that physical aspect to it. It was essentially like that training camp that you go to, that you're no longer just given the job description, but you are also now running the course and learning everything in a very adverse environment. We talked last time about how iron is purified and metals are purified within a furnace. And you talk about this extreme notion that your faith comes to be purified in a very difficult position, in a very vulnerable state. And we see how in this aspect of Hijrah, this came to be. And as we mentioned that the most significantly of Hijrah was this concept of tawakkul, the most concept of putting trust in Allah, but also planning, working, and then trusting. We see the Prophet ﷺ planned, that he made alliances, he made treaties, he made these pledges, he gathered the support. We see that he worked to then get certain people going. We see that he worked to get his debt settled so he doesn't just leave and, just is leaving a void, that he's tying his loose ends and then trusting in Allah that, hey, I'm going to make this migration, even though that there's tremendous risk associated with it, not just in terms of its the risk of it in terms of a health risk and just a economic risk and all that stuff to my person, but also for my society, for my tie, for my tribe, all these different things. And so now we come to a new home. We see the Prophet ﷺ come to a new home in Quba, and coming to a new home in Quba, which is actually just outside Yathrib. So going into Yathrib by way of Quba, which is a small village, as I mentioned, just on the southern outskirts of Yathrib or Medina. And the Prophet ﷺ, once he comes to this small village, there's some supporters that are there as well. And this becomes the site, this comes the place of the first mosque, that the foundations are set where the Prophet ﷺ establishes a mosque here in Quba and tells the people upon entering a very powerful piece of advice that, O people, give unto one another greetings of peace, feed food up to the hungry, honor the ties of kinship, pray in the hours that people sleep, and even so, if you should do this, you will enter paradise in peace. And so we see a beginning of peace and we see a closing of peace. And we see the significance of this. The Prophet ﷺ came and it was very straightforward. It was very simple. It wasn't something that was like, okay, hey, now that the Muslims are here, we need you to memorize all these things. We need you all to do this. We need you all to do that. And putting an unbearable burden on either people who are newly converted to Islam, people who had just migrated, people who are not even Muslim. They just happen to be living there. Like, all right, hey, we got some Muslim neighbors. What is the significance there? Be like, you know, to see the values that are being lifted up. Give unto one another greetings of peace. Make the salam. Say salam. Have a mutual love and understanding for one another. Be neighbors. You know, be nice to each other, first and foremost. Feed the hungry. You know, care for those who are most vulnerable. Honor the ties of kinship. Just be mindful that your family is not something that's just a forgotten or just like, you know, forgotten concept. Just like think about that there's that you have your ties to not just the people around you, but you also have ties to your relatives, your elders, you have your children, you have your spouses. Be mindful of those ties, and then pray in the hours that people sleep. Make the sacrifice to pray when it's not easy, because there's benefit that's there. And then how that will be the reward will be paradise for such people. But you don't see a overbearing of these things. These are fairly straightforward things that common people can aspire to, regardless of where they might be at. So we see then how he stays a few days at Quba and then comes into Yathrib. And you see this, some traditions narrate that there is a celebration, that people are singing songs and beating drums. Other people say that that happens at a different occasion, that there's a different instance where that happens, because at the time Yathrib is still a small Muslim community. There's not a lot of people there. It's not that the whole town is Muslim. Muslims are still a fairly small minority in this concept. So you still have some of the people of Yathrib that are there, but you also have the migrants. So you don't have a huge community there, but you have a substantive community that is there. We see how the foundation in Yathrib, which as I mentioned, its name changes to Medina over time, or the city, it changes. How in this city that became the city of the Prophet ﷺ, that it became, we see that one of the first things that took place was the founding of the mosque and the home of the Prophet ﷺ. And it's very beautiful how this mosque was founded, that the tradition has that the Prophet ﷺ had let his camel basically just kind of go through the city and settle down. Wherever the camel would settle down, the Prophet ﷺ would build his mosque and attach his home to that spot. And so this camel goes and sets down in a property that actually belonged to two orphans. So think about that. It's people often say that, oh, you know, it belongs to two orphans. The Prophet ﷺ had, you know, respected that right and had bought the property from them. So, you know, you see this mutual exchange that was there, even though they wanted to give it to him. They're like, no, just take it. He was like, no, I want to pay you for this. There's a value in that that we'll talk about. And then there's also a value in the fact that these orphans had property. Now there's so much that can be said, but you just think about the values of Medina when you contrast to Mecca. We'll talk about that in a little bit here, but you know, we talked about how orphans and the revelation that was coming down in the Meccan time was one that uplifted care for the orphans, the one that uplifted not disregarding the orphans, one that uplifted giving the orphan their due. And so we see in this aspect, these orphans own property. So we talked about how last time the Medinan city, the Medinan settlement, Yathrib, had some more connection to that original Arab ethic of these ethics of virtues, these virtues of ties of kinship, these virtues of respect, these virtues of generosity, and all these different things that were part of the Arabian ethic, but which got diluted, especially in the Meccan society, for something like commerce and trade and economic mobility and all these different things. So we see in this sense that Medina, you can get an idea that the values are a little bit different. Orphans were holding property. So they hadn't been confiscated or anything yet. You see that there's something that's there that's a little bit different than what's in Mecca. Might not be a huge significant deal, but it tells you that the type of people the Prophet ﷺ is working with maybe are closer a little bit to those original ethics, original ties to those virtues that were good for the most part, which had been lost in Mecca. So we talk about how, as well, the Prophet ﷺ, we just mentioned that he bought this property from the two orphans, that it tells you that as well. He could have just said, oh, thanks for your donation, appreciate it, we'll build the mosque here. It tells you how the Prophet ﷺ said no. You know, even as a prophet of God, even as someone who is a community builder, he said, no, everything has its due. Everyone has their due. And you know, no good deed will just be left unaccounted for, just be taken. Like every sacrifice should be, will be noted down. And in this case, he recognized these are two orphans. You know, if I take their property, this might be the only thing that they have. So he compensates them for it and gives them that aspect before making the mosque. So we see the Prophet ﷺ is cognizant of people's backgrounds, people's needs, people's situations, even though they might be Muslims, they might be like, hey man, you just take it. We don't need anything. He recognizes their condition and he wants to make sure that they are also benefited and they are recompensed for that. So we see in Medina how the Prophet ﷺ and in Yathrib and now Medina, how the Prophet ﷺ begins to build a community. As we had mentioned before, Yathrib, the settlement had been just a collection of settlements that had a lot of inter-tribal, inter settlement conflict that was taking place, whether between the tribes of the Aus and the Khazraj or other tribes. We talked about how there's almost over 20 Jewish tribes that were there. There's other tribes that were there. So there wasn't a central unity. There was a lot of dislocation, but there wasn't anything central. So think about Mecca, think about Medina, think about how Mecca had something very centralized, and very literally there was a central aspect to Mecca. There was no Kaaba in Medina, and so people didn't revolve around the center. There wasn't a defined center. People were just kind of in their own hamlets, they're in their own fortresses, they're doing their own thing, and so there wasn't this concept of unity. And so you had the challenge of creating a society in Medina, not just with improved Arab ethics that they knew, but you had this challenge of recalibrating those ethics for Islamic ethics, but also establishing centrality, establishing a connection to the center, and binding everybody together rather than just having this dislocation and this fragmentation that existed. So we see how the society was aimed to be created with this, not just this aspect of being everybody being Muslim or everybody being this, but having forbearance, having these qualities of doing good, being neighborly, doing all these things that are the root of a good community. And as I mentioned, the comparison with Mecca, Mecca was the chief feature of it was having this increase of commerce, wealth, exploitation, and eventually this individualism that just completely shed so many of those original highly held virtues of pre-Islamic Arabia. Whereas in Medina, it wasn't really comparable on that scale. You don't have a market center. You don't have a center that's huge in its economy, its trade. It's more agrarian. It's more farming. And there's no kind of central unity. So you don't have the same type of issues that are kind of going on. You have something very different. And so we see that there's room for Islam to address different things in a different city here. But we see how the Prophet ﷺ as kind of, you know, helping to build the new marketplace, also on the side helped to establish a marketplace for the Muslims. So you see that he helped build a mosque, but he also helps to build a marketplace. And so you see the significance of economic integrity as well as independence, as well as the balance of deen and dunya, that, hey, I'm not just going to give them a refuge and just say, hey, now you're safe or whatnot, but to give them agency, to help put people to work, to help get them on their feet so that they aren't dependent on other people. As they had learned through that journey of the Hijrah, they no longer can depend on just other people for this. They have to have trust in Allah. And as they came back into a community, the Prophet ﷺ capitalized on that and said, all right, we're gonna take to the next step. We're gonna have our own marketplace. We're going to excel economically and advance. And so you see how practicing Islam in that aspect differs from where it did in Mecca. That in Mecca, you had a Muslim community that was scattered, that was powerless, they were persecuted, they were abandoned by many of their tribesmen. There's never a central control that was there. They had the means of social material and as well as community establishment were really limited. And so revelation that came down just met them describing Islamic principles that helped change the mentality, change their mindset, establish and rework those values. That's where the revelation came and addressed them. In Medina, however, you see that the affairs now rested in their hands. They had their own autonomy. They had liberty. They had the liberty to erect their own pillars of the community. They had, they had now revelation coming that was telling them how to govern, how to be a community, how to function, how to do all these things that were beyond just what your religious ideology is, what your theology is, all these different things. You see the establishment of a community. So we see how it's a little bit different from Mecca into Medina. And in Medina as well, we see that it's not just that the Prophet and his companions have now found an oasis, which Yathrib or Medina was. It was an oasis. But you don't just see that. You see that the Prophet intentionally goes to build a community, intentionally goes to create a community that allows for autonomy of all people that are living in that community. So we see the drafting of the Constitution of Medina or the Pact of Medina that is very famous and very well known by Western as well as Muslim scholars, in which you see that the highlights of it being that how the Prophet ﷺ recognizes that in this community of Medina, in this community that they're living in, the Jews are one community with the Muslims. So regardless of their faith, they are in this constitution, they are part of the community with Muslims. There's a freedom of religion that's granted. There's autonomy of these groups. There's mutual defense and mutual respect that is established or at least put in the clauses. You have a continuation of justice that there will be, if someone is wrong, that doesn't mean that this treaty is one that will just look over that. People who have done wrong will be brought to justice and there will be retribution. And so you see that these ethics were all upheld, but you also see that you have things transcending beyond tribal ties, that one tribe is going to do this, one tribe is going to be favored over another. You don't have any of that. You have, we're all in this together. We're all a community. And this is how we're going to learn how to play together. We're going to play nicely, and this is how we're going to do it. And so we see the significance of a pluralistic community that doesn't necessarily just change into just merging people and blending their identities regardless of where they came from. It acknowledges that. Otherwise, you don't see why the Prophet ﷺ would have said, okay, hey, the Jews are one community. It doesn't just highlight to say, hey, all of Medina is one community. He highlights the significance of their own people, their own tribe, their own identity, and then honors their freedom of religion as well. And so we see how you have now this mosque, this pact that is made, this community is built, the stones of the mosque are put together. And we see during the construction of the home and the mosque of the Prophet, the Prophet himself is there helping his companions build it. It's not, he has the absolute right to say, hey, I'm just going to be someone who's like an overseer, make the mosque like this, this big, all these different things. He's there. He's there sharing in that struggle, just like he shared in the struggle of migration, just like he shared in the struggle of persecution, just like he shared in all these different ways. His sharing, even now that he's been appointed as this leader over this tribe or this settlement, this community, even though he's been appointed as a de facto leader, he has not been removed from his people. So he continues and he helps brick by brick to assemble his community and his mosque as well. And so we see how you have this mosque and its Qibla, its direction of prayer is facing Jerusalem, which eventually will be called in a couple of years to change to Mecca, to again consolidate this identity. We see a call to prayer that is established at this time. So as the mosque is finally built, we see a call to prayer that is established from the Adhan, the Muslim call to prayer in which Bilal, the one who was the former slave, the slave who we mentioned was shouting in the desert while hot boulders were put on his chest that God is one, that Ahadun Ahad, he is one, that there's just one. That voice that was in the margins became the voice that would be the voice of the community. And what's really significant, apart from this uplifting of people of the margins and the oppressed, you see also how this Adhan came to play. Bilal was seen in a dream of a companion, Abdullah ibn Zayd, who saw a dream that said, you know, this is what I'm seeing as how we should call to our prayer. Prior to this, you know, the Prophet was thinking, the community was thinking that maybe we should have things like how the Jews have with the horn, or maybe we should have a bell. Maybe we should have somebody just do something else, like whatever it might be. Let's just, how do we figure out how to get people to the mosque? And so this Abdullah ibn Zayd had a dream in which he saw the adhan, essentially. This adhan being recited and people coming to prayer. And so he relayed that to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ said, yeah, let's do it. This is perfect. Like, you know, teach Bilal, because Bilal has this strong oratory gift. So teach it to him. He'll do it. But we see in this aspect as well, the Prophet ﷺ, we see another testament to his prophethood that someone else had just received some kind of inspiration or vision. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't feel threatened by it. Didn't be like, oh, hey, wait, why did you get that? And I didn't. It's like, oh, hey, no, you're not supposed to get that. Why did my revelation come to you? Like, what's going on? So you don't see any of that kind of competition that's there. You see the Prophet ﷺ be like, wow, like, you know, that's beautiful. Like, you had a vision, you had a dream. That's so cool. Like, you know, go teach it, especially when it aligns with what we're wanting to do. So you see this kind of happen in terms of the Prophet ﷺ not just being there to help build up his community brick by brick, but he helps build up the people, build up the people at the margins, build up the people who have contributions to make. He doesn't just say, hey, if everything goes through me. He lifts it up brick by brick, everybody. So you think about this brick building, you think about this community building. It's not just done by one person all here, but you see him building things at a different level and building it together. And so we see as the community is now built, as they have a mosque, as they have an alliance, as they have all these things, they start to have adopting and putting actually in consolidating their rituals, their five daily prayers, fasting. You see the mosque becoming a center of affairs and conduct and different things that are, it's a center of learning, it's a center of prayer, it's a center of interaction, all these different things that the mosque comes to serve, but it also has rooms that are built for the Prophet ﷺ as well as his wives, Sauda and Aisha. And so we just will briefly mention here, I think we may have talked about it last time, but after the Prophet ﷺ's wife Khadija passed away, 1 year after her death, the Prophet ﷺ married Sauda, who was also a widow. She's a widow who was a double migrant. She was someone who migrated to Abyssinia, and then after her husband passed away, she migrated back, and then she went on the Hijrah after the Prophet ﷺ. But she was someone who also migrant. She was someone who was not by any means, you know, seen as at least in tradition here, that someone that's like, you know, oh, like, you know, she's, people are highly seeking after to marry her. She was just someone who was suggested for the Prophet ﷺ, not maybe on so much of grounds of physical attraction or anything, but someone that the Prophet ﷺ, who still has, you know, four daughters, that someone can, who can kind of help take care of them and help him in his domestic duties as he's, you know, doing his own religious duties and things like that. And so she was someone who he married. And then we also have just shortly after him marrying Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr. And there's a huge debate that takes place on her age. You know, was she betrothed when she was 6? Was she married when she was 9? Or was she married when she was like 17 or 20 or so on? There is a link in the syllabus that I'm happy to share, but check out there's a few articles on Yaqeen Institute that talk about the age of Aisha. There's cases for an older age. There's a case about her age and talking about the different views on it. So I will leave that for that time. But you see in this aspect, what we can take away in this concept was that, in this moment, was that this was in the 11th year or so, at least for when he married Sauda, at least 11 years after his first revelation. The Prophet ﷺ was 51. The people who he's marrying here, you see that the reasons weren't sexual or hedonistic. He had four daughters. He needed help with his domestic cause, but he also, you know, was just someone who's really grieved after he lost his best friend. He was someone who was needing emotional support and connection, and he was missing that. He missed his wife. And so, you know, he was suggested for him to remarry. And so at this time, you know, he had been married. He had been married in a monogamous relationship for 25 years, which is something fairly unheard of in this society. And so you see that his marriages that are to come are not done for reasons of exploitation or you know, a lot of this perversion that we might have been the smears that are kind of launched at the Prophet, but you see just from a practical reason, you see from an emotional perspective, a man who just lost his wife of 25 years, who had all of these qualities, but also all of these things that she had done for him, that she was for him, the void that leaves, you know, remarrying someone who's also a widow, who's also, you know, just who's, you know, been a firm Muslim believer and whatnot. You see these aspects come in, then you remove that, oh, Muhammad was just someone who's just after women. You know, he's just someone who's like this. No, that's not the case at all. When we look at his example there. And we'll come back to this discussion of the Prophet's marriages, inshallah, in future sessions. But we see that after the Hijrah, Sauda, who is his new wife, is one who is escorted to Medina along with his daughters. And so they come after. And so you see that the Prophet wasn't the last person to leave Mecca, but he had his family that was still there. And so you see that in this dislocation, in this moving, you still have family that's back there. You know, for whatever reason it may be, they have family that is not yet ready to come, or is that is coming, waiting for him to get there, things like that. And so think about the separation. These were his daughters. These were people that the Prophet loved to see, loved to play with, loved to just be able to be interacting with. And you see, when they're not there, what does that still mean for him? Like, is his home really a home? Because he stayed with a companion, or he stayed with one of the people of Medina, Abu Ayyub, in his house while his mosque and home were being built. And so just imagine, like, you know, his kids are still, you know, waiting to come, and, you know, all these different things. And so you see that there's this aspect that of separation that is there, that this awaiting that takes place. So as we kind of look into a little bit the closing here, just a few things that in Medina, not everything went perfectly. We see that there was trouble brewing. There was an epidemic that broke out affected Abu Bakr, Bilal, and others who came down with fevers and, you know, just different kind of sicknesses. But you have the adjustment to a new climate, to a new place. And so, you know, people aren't really used to where they are. It takes adjustment. So you have a physical adjustment that's taking place. But then also we see, you know, various alliances and pacts that are strengthening the city. Normally, we see a lot of pushback and resentment because there's now a concession of power. There's a concession as well of leadership, but then also there's a newfound responsibility for defense that some people might not have thought about or probably wanted. We see pushback from some local tribes, and we see some pushback from some of the Jewish tribes as well. Some of their leaders, notably in the Khazraj, you have Abdullah ibn Ubay, you have Abu Amr ibn Sayfi. You have these people that are, you know, upset the Prophet is now this person who's holding this mantle of leadership by de facto leadership. So they're upset out of their jealousy and whatnot. So you see these the power grab that is kind of fueling these sentiments. And so you see that pushback is coming from there. But it's important that we look in that language when we talk about how these tribes or these groups had opposed the Prophet. Oftentimes you see it said that, oh, the Jews of Medina opposed the Prophet, or the Jews did this, or the Jews did that. It's very important for us to be mindful and be aware of different kind of anti-Semitic kind of labelings that we can do, because it's very dishonest, and it's a big disservice to just say that all of them were like this, or all of these people were like that. It's not the case. You dig into the reasons, and we look at the humanistic aspect that, you know, these tribes that were there, some of them were Jewish, some of them were not, had various concerns that whether it was for power reasons, or whether it was for economic reasons, whether it was for just, you know, just their own status quo, they felt disrupted there. We want to lift up and really dive into those reasons there, like what's the humanistic reasons beyond the fact that, oh, hey, they were Jews, and so they're opposed to the Prophet. No, that's not the case at all. And we want to do a better service to the history and the legacy of the Prophet ﷺ and the community he tried to build in the opposition that he faced and the pushback that he faced, than simply pandering to labels and things like that. So we want to be sure to be mindful of that. So we see the Prophet ﷺ settling fights between different communities. You have a fight between the Aus and the Khazraj that breaks out, and see the Prophet coming to them, pleading to him, saying, have you come back to Jahiliyyah? Have you come back to that state of ignorance, that state of just pre-Islamic ignorance, in which you are devoid of kind of any connection or any mindfulness, that when Allah has cut the fetters of ignorance from you, when he has delivered you from unbelief and united their hearts, and while I'm still among you, have you done that? And so you see what the Prophet is talking about, that these people were familiar with Jahiliyyah, even though they were Aus and Khazraj, they were in Yathrib or Medina, they were familiar with what Jahiliyyah was. They were familiar with that state. And so he makes that ethos appeal. He's like, hey, like, you know, what are y'all doing? Are y'all going back to that? And so he reworks that tribal mindset. And as he reworks that, he also initiates another pact. This is now known as the Pact of Brotherhood, or Mu'akha. So he makes a brothering of sorts. He pairs one of the immigrants with a helper. So with the helper, the Ansar, the people who are in Yathrib, in Medina, who receive the Muslims who are emigrating, who are the Muhajirun. Those people are called the Ansar, the people who are in Medina, who are the hosts, who are receiving the immigrants, who are the Muhajirun, and he makes a pact of brothering. So he brothers and makes a pair of one Ansar, or one person of the Ansar, and one person of the Muhajirin. So you have each of these two people who are together, and he bonds them on this basis of a brotherhood that goes beyond the tie of tribalism, beyond the ties of kinship, beyond any of these ties, and overrides these notions of the Arabic ties of brotherhood or any of these things. And so you see that there is one of a brothering that is done based on tradition of Islam, based on faith and faith alone. And so you see this building block essentially there. And so now, as we just close out here, we see how the Prophet, once he establishes community, once he establishes a community that is not just an alliance of different factions or whatnot, but has common principles and common ground through different pacts, through different values, and through more of a centralized aspect. They now have a mosque. They have literally an institution that they can go in and out of. There's all these things that are being done. You see now the Prophet ﷺ goes into the resistance mode. The Prophet ﷺ goes in outward facing. We see that at the time, prior to the Hijrah, as well as during the Hijrah, there is a confiscation of property that's been left behind. You see a continued expulsion, the expulsion of people being removed, people who had to flee, people who were arrested, people who were, just taken into custody, all these different things during the Hijrah of the Prophet ﷺ and of the Muslim community, as well as this ongoing persecution. You see this concept of caravan raids coming about, that there are these raids being done that are not done with the intention of harming a person or harming people, but to extract goods and resources and camels and weapons, that are done in response to this confiscation of property, to this expulsion, to this persecution, to this oppression. So you see a resistance that's being put out. It was a common practice that was in the Arabian society at the time of, and in times of hardship, especially in our ethical framework, in our worldview. This is we often see the narrative of Muhammad was a raider. He was just like a highway robber. He was doing this and that. But we do it a disservice when critics look at it from that lens and don't give it its due. That the Prophet ﷺ was not just doing this just to pick a bone or just because he just wanted to rob people. They had intentionally been wronged themselves. Their property had been stolen. They'd been basically essentially kicked out of their homes. They had to resort. To a way to kind of even out the playing field, in a sense. And so this was a common practice. This was something that was understood, but also something that was done from a lens of economic necessity. We see that most of the people who came from Mecca, the emigrants, the Muhajirin, they were merchants. They were traders. They were people who struggled in Medina. And then you have a land of farmers, which is Medina or Yathrib, where the monopoly of control was really established in certain factions, but also it's an agrarian society. What are merchants and traders gonna primarily do until their businesses get built up? And so you see that the Prophet ﷺ only sends immigrants on these raids. Only the Muhajirun are sent on these raids. He doesn't include the people who are the ones who hosted them, because they don't have a bone to pick with the people who kicked them out. So as I mentioned, it's different. It's difficult to understand in our peace conscious age. We have a difference of our concept of a religious community that's just a community that goes to their sacred space once a week and they just pray together. They do these nice events and these niceties and that's it. But in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, you have a religious community that is one that is interdependent, that's connected, and that has a political aspect to it, that has a holistic aspect. And so we see how one of these raids, the Prophet ﷺ sent many of these raids. Most of them didn't come to bear any fruit or any major victory at all. But we see one raid in particular that actually started to roll the ball for where we'll go next time, inshallah, and brother. So I'll just mention it briefly and then we'll conclude here. But you have the raid at Nakhla. Nakhla was where a place between Mecca and Taif. Taif, if you recall, was the place that the Prophet ﷺ went to seek refuge. And Mecca in between there is Nakhla. And so Nakhla was this place that the Prophet ﷺ had sent his cousin, Abdullah ibn Jahsh, to go and scout a caravan, just to, again, just check it out. He was only given to instructions to observe. So he was sent with a raiding party, per se, to just go observe, don't do anything, just see what they've got. They're studying these caravans that are coming up and down in the north and whatnot. So check out this caravan, see what it's got, and then come back to us, we'll make a plan. But they see this caravan, they see that it's not that well guarded, and they see that it's got a few things, and they've come all this way. All right, let's just dive in and take it. And so the raiders go attack the caravan, and there's, I believe, like three or so Meccans that are there, of which they see that, they start to fight back. So one of the Meccans is killed, and then they take two of the Meccans as hostage. Maybe another one, I believe, runs away or so. But, you have this mess that occurs. And it was especially difficult because of the fact that this was done during the sacred months, one of the sacred months of pre-Islam as well as in Islam, of Rajab, and happened at the very last night of this holy month. And of course, fighting is prohibited in this time. It's recognized by non-Muslims, it's recognized by the Muslims. And so the Prophet, when he heard about this, when he saw them come, he was very upset. He was very just overcome with this. And he was just like, what have you done? Like, I did not tell you to do this. And you see the Quran actually comes in revelation that talks about how, yes, fighting in the forbidden, in the months that are sacred is bad, but persecution is worse. Oppression is worse than murder. There is justification for certain things in certain times. And so it makes a communal appeal, because you can imagine that people in Medina who are not Muslim were like, look what the Muslims just did. Look now what they did. They probably brought war upon us. They've done all this stuff, all these different things that are being talked about, whether they're from people who are, from Muslims or from people who are non-Muslims or any of these other people who start to mention these things. You see the Quran also talks about how the mutual defense, the communal appeal to monasteries, churches, synagogues, mosques in that order are needed for defense, that if these are to be left, that they would be completely destroyed if there's not this communal ethic, this defense that's put up, that's a full front, that if people were not put up to defend these places, or put up at least enabled by Allah, that these places would be attacked. And so you see a communal appeal that names mosques at the end. And so we see that these raids help give not just the Muslims a chance to get economically equal in terms of what the disadvantage that they had left from the Hijrah, but you see that it helps give the Muslims a idea of the topography, the geography of the land. They get a survey of the land that they're new to. They're familiar, because like I said, these raids were taken on by the Quraysh. They're not by the Quraysh, by the Muhajirun, the people who are emigrating, not the people who were the helpers or the Ansar or the natives to Medina. These were people who were coming from Mecca. They had a chance to study the topography. They got the lay of the land. They got a chance to see the trade routes, contacting local settlements and tribes, towns, and also had a chance to give this type of bravado that, like, you know, to give a message to the Quraysh in Mecca that, hey, the Muslim aren't playing games. They're lashing out. Like, you know, they're going to defend themselves. They're going to use means of economic blockade, even though they were just a persecuted minority. So it instills this aspect of fear in the eyes of the people who are persecuting that, hey, there is a resistance that's being built up. So next time, inshallah, we'll talk about the Battle of Badr. Inshallah, we'll talk as well about the Battle of Uhud. But 15 years after the revelation, 2 years after the migration, is the Battle of Badr. And we'll see how these raids, this concept of these raids, these caravan raids, leads up to that and leads up to the Battle of Badr. But we'll also talk a little bit more about the significance there. So inshallah, thank you so much for tuning in to our session today. Inshallah, we will see you all at the next session where we cover the Battle of Badr. If there are any questions or any comments or concerns, please feel free to reach out. Again, we will be doing this Seerah series for 10 sessions. And so now we are already 4 sessions in. So inshallah, we'll see y'all at session 5 and we'll continue from there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.